Oh yeah, I've been listening. No, sorry, listening. I've checked out and watched the interview with Yeomi Park, the North Korea defector that was on Joe Rogan recently. She's been doing the podcasting rounds as of what the last few months. She was on Jordan Peterson. She went on Lex Fridman. I'm not too sure the other one. She went on something else, but she's been around, right? Which is kind of part of course. I'd assume she's got a book coming out or something, or just wants to increase her profile. It's not really too big of a deal. But the content of what she said, obviously, on Joe Rogan was super harrowing, especially when you put it into contrast with what people are arguing about on social media for the most part, apart from COVID, when it comes to all the cultural war stuff that doesn't really matter, in the grand scheme of things. To get somebody speaking so honestly and upfront about the horrors of North Korea, however inflated or deflated you think her account is, because now there's articles coming out basically debunking some of the stuff that she says and picking out inconsistencies in her stories. And we don't know this woman. I don't know how old she is. She might be late 30s or early 30s, or maybe even in her 20s still. She defected from North Korea when she was 13. I would imagine a lot of her memories aren't necessarily pieced together all too well. There's a language barrier, loads of things going on. I'm not going to hold her to account too much if she said, oh, I jumped my way over the border, and then you found that the last interview said she walked. Do you know what I mean? I don't really give a shit, really. I still think the content of what she said is super interesting in terms of getting a peek into a country that we have no idea what's going on. Do I believe it's a complete hellscape as some people do say it is? Probably not. Is it as great as some of the Korean government try to purport it to be when they invite flipping YouTubers and influencers? And that's another one, so that I never understood. No one really cancels or has a real. Is there a bit of? I've never really seen people kick off and get outraged at YouTubers and stuff who decide to go to North Korea and go on those kind of package tours that they put people on and put them in those weird coaches and take them around a clearly set up area of their city in order to make it seem as if everything is nice and normal. Take them to a fairly affluent only, well, take them to a hotel that only the rich and famous types in North Korea are able to go to, in order to make it seem as if they have all the, trappings and luxuries of Western life. Of course not, right? But it's interesting that no one really seems to kick a fuss about those influencers that do that, really. That's really bizarre. But if you dare to say that you don't believe in vaccines or that you think COVID is a joke, people want you to essentially be hung from a bridge somewhere. Wild. But regardless, I thought, again, the context of what she said was really interesting. The stuff about catching cockroaches and, whatever insects and eating rats and dead people being piled upon the street and whatnot is just insane. And again, just interesting to note that for all the world police stuff that America does, they haven't tried to kind of poke the bear when it comes to North Korea. They haven't ever tried to kind of, peek behind the Iron Curtain and try to relieve their citizens of the tyranny that they're living under and welcoming into the arms of democracy and capitalism. Hasn't necessarily happened. They've just kind of left them alone and kind of turned a blind eye to all the people dying and soldiers running across the flipping, what you call it, border with flipping worms all over their bodies and shit. They don't really seem to care too much about that, which is another interesting part as well. That where's that soldier? He's not really talking too much in it, but that might be a real good illustration of just how similar, just how much universal the human experience is the world over, right? In North Korea, where people are living under this tyrannical rule, a woman escapes and then she doesn't stop shutting up about her experience, right? And it's Yeomi Park. And then that guy who is a soldier, who I think, if I'm not mistaken, when he ran across the border to South Korea, he got shot several times. Again, like I said, his body was full of ringworms and he was malnourished. He was like on death's door and he managed to sprint, the best part of 800 meters in order to kind of get to safety, and he just about escaped. And we haven't really heard a peep from this guy, maybe because he doesn't speak English. But it's just interesting that there isn't much difference in terms of how people do things around the world, especially mostly based on their gender. The woman doesn't sort of shine up and the guy is somewhere, just minding his business, doing what dudes do. But yeah, her accounts were super harrowing, man. What a way to kind of send to you and kind of get you back to normality and kind of make you, you know, think of all the things that you complain about not really mattering that much, especially when you think about the other people around the world who are suffering through tyrannical governments. You know, think of people that are living in Hungary. You think of all the flooding that's been happening in parts of Europe and stuff. It's just this stuff that's been going on, you know, on a daily basis that we've probably been purposely and maybe for our mental health, which is kind of advisable to do, just been kind of put into the side and be like, you know what, I don't want to pay attention to it. I don't want to think too much about it because if I do, it's going to freak me out. But it is interesting, or it is good perspective wise to kind of be reminded that, hey, as much bad as it is over here, there are people that are legitimately fighting for their lives every single day, and the things that we take for granted, you know, for them is like a luxury. So that was crazy to see. And again, even some of the skepticism, I'm not too mad at. I think that one article that if I'm not mistaken, the one article that Tim Dillon shared about it was pretty fair in some of his criticisms about Yomi Park in terms of her as a person and all this malarkey. I didn't necessarily think it was a bad thing personally. Let me see if I can get it up. Tim Dillon. There he goes on Twitter. Let's see it again. Boom, boom, boom. I did feel the criticism of her on that thingy article was too shabby. If everything, it was probably just healthy skepticism about some of the accounts that she put forward and some of the stories and the details involved in it. But again, the substance of it is still what it is, isn't it? Like, you're living in a country where you essentially aren't being fed. You aren't being really looked after too well. Your country, you know, there's no just sanctions against it. You don't really get much foreign aid. And you're all basically fending for yourself in a place where if you might listen to the wrong track, you might get hung or executed in a flipping stadium in front of all your neighbors. Do you know what I mean? Like, I wonder if that's even a concern. The fact that you're going to get assassinated sooner rather than later, or the fact that you're going to end up, you know, with your ass hanging out from your face in front of your neighbors in a massive stadium. I wonder if people even care about that kind of thing. Maybe at that point, you're just kind of, you know, fed up. But let me see if I can find it. Where is it? He posted the article about her. There he is. Yeah, this is the one. It's from The Diplomat. It's a fairly lengthy article, but I'll just read the first couple of bits that basically, you know, throw some cold water on some of the, you know, pieces of information that Yomi Park retold. This was in 2014, actually, so there's people out there who have been skeptical about her account since then. And again, most of it might be, again, politically motivated in some respects, because there is a weird, I guess, because she's kind of, you know, been doing her rounds in North America, and for whatever reason has tended to be more welcomed within this kind of right-leaning side of media more so than the left side of the media. And then now people are using it as a thing. I don't really know. It's America. It's fucking bizarre. They always turn everything into like a Democrat-Republican thing when she has nothing to do with them whatsoever. But hey, so this is the article here. It's courtesy of Diplomat. It says, The Strange Tale of Yonmi Park, right? If they pronounce it, Yonmi Park. It says here, when the 21-year-old North Korean defector made her debut on the world stage in October this year, the harrowing tales of her life under repressive North Korean regime and her perilous escape to freedom. She left audiences, human rights heavyweights and journalists in tears, some literally sobbing. Wearing a pink traditional dress with a high-waisted voluminous skirt, Park stood before the lectern at one of the Young World Summit in Dublin, and in two long pauses, wiping tears from her eyes and holding her hand to her mouth as she composed herself, she told of being brainwashed, of seeing executions, of starvings, or the sliver of light in her darkness. And when she watched the Hollywood blockbuster Titanic and had her mind opened to the outside world, was where love was possible. Yeah, this is a bit too much, isn't it? She said Titanic is what opened her eyes to the Western world. Like, come on, lady. Why not Die Hard? They said here, and her mind opened to the Western world where love was possible, and of having to watch her mother being raped, of burying her father, own on 14, threatening to kill herself after, rather than allow Mongolian soldiers to send her back to North Korea. Bloody hell. She talked about following the stars of freedom and then ended her with her signature sign off. When I was crossing the Gobi Desert and scared of dying, I thought nobody cared, but you have to listen to my story. But you have listened to my story. You have cared, right? And, you know, she wore that traditional Korean outfit as well to the speech that she gave. You know, good way to kind of, you know, get the optics right and the branding. And it continues to say, you'd have to be inhuman not to be moved, but for But you're going to hear a lot of buts. Was a story that she told her life in North Korea accurate? The more speeches and interviews I read and watch and hear Park give, the more I become aware of serious inconsistencies in her story. That suggests it wasn't. And whether this matters is up to the reader to decide, but my concern is if someone with such a high profile twists their story to fit a narrative we have come to expect from North Korean defectors, our perspective on the country could become dangerously skewed. We need to have a full and truthful picture of life in North Korea if we're to help those living under the abysmal cruel regime and those who try to flee. Cool, which is fair, in it. And I guess in the whole article she kind of picks apart some of the cases and inconsistencies that are there, but then there is a pretty level-headed response here from Yeomi Park at the end of the article, which says here, a response from Yeomi Park, and it says, I want to thank Marianne Jolly for caring so much about the terrible situation of Korea that she would point out any inconsistencies in my quotes and how my story had been reported. Much of the time there was miscommunication because of the language barrier. I've only learned English in the last year, and I'm trying hard to improve every day to be a better advocate for my people. I apologize for my misunderstanding. For example, I never said I saw executions in Haesan. My friend's mother was executed in a small city in central North Korea. My mother still has relatives, which is why I don't want to name it. And there was mountains that you can see even on Google Earth. Maybe you can call them big hills in English outside of Haesan that we cross and escape. There are many more examples like this. But one very important thing to correct. I don't have any foundation. The website was a dummy site by my friend. I also apologize that there has been times when my childhood memories were not perfect, like how long my father was sentenced to prison. Now I'm checking with my mom and other to correct everything. I'm also writing a book about my life in North Korea, my escape through China, and my work to promote human rights. This is where I'll be telling my story. In the meantime, I want to thank you all for your patience and kindness to me, which is a pretty brilliant level-headed adult response, because most of the time you feel like whenever people are being called out for their inconsistencies or their lack of information or lack of clarity or just question for their credibility, they tend to kind of go into their show and get a little bit aggravated and angry, which rightfully so. But I like the fact that she was mature enough to reply in that way. But that aside, I still recommend you check out the interview. It's on the JRE now at the moment. I think it might be one of the most recent interviews. The Spotify player is absolutely terrible, so you have to just bear with it and let it play out. I found that after about 40 minutes, it tends to stop doing that whole pausing buffering thing. It still does that annoying thing where even though you pay for premium, you still get an ad or two that plays, which is legitimately one of the most insane things I've ever seen, especially when you consider you're paying for the premium service on Spotify, but you still get ads on the Joe Rogan Experience podcast. But again, I love the guy, so it is what it is. But if you stick with it for the first 30-40 minutes, it should stop buffering and it should be okay after that. But yeah, definitely a real sobering interview to check out if you are complaining and kind of getting upset about stuff that doesn't really matter in the big grand world, in it. Oh yeah, in the world at the moment.